Also erstmal herzlichen Dank für die netten, schmeichelnden, einführenden Worte. Sehr geehrte Magnifizienz, sehr geehrte Spektabilität, liebe Kollegen, Kolleginnen, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, es freut mich hier sehr, Sie heute zu dieser Antrittsvorlesung mit dem Titel eben die Zusammensetzung der Atmosphäre im globalen Wandel begrüßen zu dürfen und im Rahmen dieser Antrittsvorlesung eben auch unser Arbeitsgebiet ein bisschen näher vorstellen zu dürfen. Bevor ich allerdings anfange, ich bei dieser Gelegenheit will ich mich gleich nochmal bedanken im Dekanat für Geo- und Atmosphärenwissenschaften, die sich sehr bemüht haben, diese Antrittsvorlesung hier zu organisieren. Danke Monika nochmal speziell. Ja, Matthias hat es schon erwähnt, da hier auch einige nicht deutschsprachige Kollegen anwesend sind und einige Studenten, die aus anderen Ländern kommen, habe ich mich entschieden, diesen Vortrag auf Englisch zu halten, obwohl ich ausdrücklich erwähnen will, dass hier Fragen, Kommentare oder etwaige andere, vielleicht auch Kritikpunkte im Anschluss diskutiert werden können auf Deutsch, sowohl auch als auf Englisch. Yeah, so I start here with a very iconic picture. Most of you know it probably, old enough probably to, some might have been old enough to have seen that. It's the iconic picture taken from one of the Apollo missions, first time showing planet Earth here from space. This is actually a remake from NASA, which is a satellite composite, a high definition image of the iconic frame showing our planet. Again, first time looked at from the outer space, and I really like that picture because it shows one unique feature, and it's a very thin layer, a shell, a blue layer, a haze that surrounds the planet that we call the atmosphere. So if we took that atmosphere and compressed it to a ball, a gas ball, that would have a pressure that we have at the surface, it would be a bubble that has a diameter of about 2,000 kilometers and a mass that sounds very high, about 5,000 trillion tons. But if you compare that to the size of the planet, we immediately recognize that even the volume here is very small. The volume of the atmosphere compared to the planet, about 3%. The mass is even smaller. So it's almost an insignificant mass compared to the mass of the planet. So meteorologists and atmospheric physicists have divided the atmosphere in different layers. I should mention that before I really get into more detail. We divide the atmosphere in different layers. The lower one called the troposphere, and even the lowest part of the troposphere that we call the planetary boundary layer. And I colored that in red because this is really the area of the atmosphere that we are specialized in, and that's the area that we look at. And the troposphere is topped by the stratosphere. I'll talk a little bit about it. But overall, if you add up all these layers, again, the mass compared to the planet is very small. And so due to the small reservoir, the atmosphere is the most vulnerable part of the Earth system, which is one hand a bad thing, but in one hand also a good thing. So if we observe things in the atmosphere, we can monitor environmental change very fast, effectively, because any change in the planet will most likely happen in the atmosphere first, especially if it relates to gases in the atmosphere. And so I'm not going to talk too much about the physical properties of the atmosphere. We have a pretty good understanding based on basic thermodynamics. Mostly I will talk about the composition of the atmosphere, and as we all know perhaps from school, it's gases like nitrogen, oxygen, these are the most dominant ones, important ones that dominate the gas mixture, but there's all these other trace gases that are present in very small levels here, so CO2 0.03% in the atmosphere, 380 ppm, and then there's a whole slew of organic trace gases or carbon trace gases that are reactive, just like methane, CO. There's trace gases like ozone that are produced in the atmosphere. And then I'll talk a little bit more about the connection between all these reactive trace gases. So this is really the research area that we focus in. We see that their concentrations are really low. And so Matthias already mentioned, this is one unique thing that also always challenges our abilities to observe these small components in the atmosphere. I'll even start more generally talking about oxygen. So we see that oxygen here is present about 20%. It's the one that's the part that we breathe in that we need to live. This is a geological picture here showing over the history of the Earth. About we go back about 4 billion years, roughly how we think that oxygen has evolved. Here the blue line, the y-axis shows the relative amount to today. So one would be the amount of today, would be 20%. And there's two distinct cases here that really define probably the composition of the atmosphere. And that's the emergence of photosynthesis. So first by blue algae, who invented, so to speak, photosynthesis, which takes out CO2 from the atmosphere and converts it. And part of that is also releases oxygen. And so that evolution here, you can see oxygen in the atmosphere increases, but only until probably 500, let's say 1 billion years ago, there's significant levels available in the atmosphere. This is one unique thing of our planet, that it's the only planet we know of that has been geoengineered by biology. But the reason I'm also showing is that concomitant with this oxygen increase, there's ozone. We can calculate an ozone been rising in the atmosphere. And so the combination, and we believe the ozone layer in particular, was also playing a role that actually life could settle on the land surface much later than it was able to inhabit the oceans, because of the protective layer of ozone, which protects a lot of protects us from UVB radiation that we receive from the sun. So it's really a connected interplay. So when we talk about oxygen, just a very brief definition. When we talk about oxygen, we have three forms in the atmosphere. The most common one is the oxygen molecule. It's two oxygen atoms. Ozone is a very reactive compound, but chemically, it's just you add another oxygen atom and you get ozone. And so these are the oxygen species that are important. And there's another important prerequisite that I have not mentioned yet, but I'm mentioning it now. That means that our atmosphere is an oxidizing atmosphere, and that means that there's a self-cleaning property of the atmosphere that's really important for the cycling of reactive trace gases in the atmosphere, and that's ultimately driven by photochemistry, so radiation in triggering complex radical formation pathways in the atmosphere that cleans the atmosphere from any pollution to a certain level. And so this is a summary now, introductory slide on ozone, the many phases of atmospheric ozone, which is a central theme when we talk about atmospheric physics and chemistry. Again, what I show here is a typical ozone profile, the altitude profile. The lower part represents the troposphere up to about 15 kilometers, topped by the stratosphere. We see that most of the atmospheric ozone is contained in the stratosphere. And we have a pretty good understanding in modeling stratospheric ozone nowadays. It's mostly driven by radiation that we receive from the sun. And ozone in the stratosphere, along with oxygen, is a very important part to protect us from damaging UV radiation. Now in the middle, upper troposphere, ozone is a very important greenhouse gas, so sometimes not not often mentioned in the connection with ozone. In the lower part, though, the really important part that ozone plays is that it's a precursor of what we call the detergent of the atmosphere, the cleaning agency of atmosphere, the OH radical. Now, we all know when ozone gets too high in the atmosphere, especially in the lower atmosphere, it's also damaging to plants and animals. And so we can see that the ozone production in the lower atmosphere must happen very different compared to the stratosphere, because the Chapman mechanism that was developed to describe stratospheric ozone production cannot explain the enhancement mixing ratio in the atmosphere down here, where ozone levels are significantly higher than originally was thought. So how does it look up there? Some who might have observed the famous space jump from Felix Baumgartner, the level he jumped off was pretty much at the level of the stratosphere where the ozone maximum peaks. So you look at this, you think you're almost in space, but indeed you're not. So you're really there where actually the ozone concentration would be high enough that would be actually also damaging immediately to our health. So the physics of ozone in the stratosphere is pretty well understood. Sometimes there's rare occasions where you can actually at least believe you can see the ozone layer. This shows a picture taken in California in 91 after the eruption of Pinatubo. And what happens here is that the volcano was injecting a lot of aerosol in the stratosphere. And after sunset, the sun radiation would be reflected at those aerosols and then was passing back through the stratosphere through ozone. And this pale haze layer here is believed, or some people would argue, that part of that could be due to ozone because ozone has an absorption minimum in that region here. Now the chemistry puzzle of the stratospheric ozone layer has also had quite a history. It took about 80 years to solve the complete puzzle. I already mentioned the first important step. Chapman in the 1930s discovered that radiation can split molecular oxygen, and then you have some chemical reactions and you finally form ozone in the stratosphere. Later on in the 50s, Bates and Nicolette observed that even higher in the atmosphere, actually in the mesosphere, the radiation is so intense that you can actually even split up water that makes it up there. And you get radicals in the form of hydrogen atoms and what we now know more extensively, Hox radicals. Now the one big breakthrough then was probably, or happened in the 70s, and there's was awarded with the Nobel Prize for Chemistry. These three guys here that finally solved the entire puzzle of the stratospheric ozone for the work in atmospheric chemistry, particularly Paul Crutzen, was investigating the effects of nitrogen compounds on the ozone layer, and Molina and Rowland discovered the effects of halocarbons which destroy the ozone layer. And so with that, really, I think the most of the open questions have been answered in the atmosphere, in the higher atmosphere, and nowadays we believe that that's pretty well understood. And as time passes, so the research moved actually down to the troposphere, where even the ozone production, we would say, is still very poorly, often poorly understood. And so I already mentioned there's a certain level of ozone that we need down in the troposphere because it helps to clean the atmosphere. But if ozone gets too high, then it gets toxic. There's toxicological studies out there with mice that say the concentration of ozone of 22 ppm, 50% of the mice would die within 3 hours. That's called the LD50. So at higher concentrations, ozone is very toxic. So that's a bad thing. And that's then when we talk about air pollution, ozone levels also become very high. So when we look back in history, so I dug out from a German Bockhaus, the old days Wikipedia, what was known in the 1930s, where of course people would know what the main constituents of the atmosphere were. There's also knowledge about CO2. Interesting enough, they also mention here tropospheric ozone, so the ozone down here, about 7 ppb, if you convert that, and I believe these measurements were done in Paris. And so these are levels that we consider almost pre-industrial levels. And so if you look at ozone nowadays, the ozone concentrations in Europe alone have increased by a factor of 10, tenfold. Typically we observe 50 to 70 ppb of ozone. Globally, it has increased by 2 to 3 times. There's much more dramatic changes in these reactive gases going on in the atmosphere than we would have, that we would sometimes believe. What was not known back then was, first of all, how was ozone formed? So back then they thought, well, it's mostly lightning storms that split air and then create ozone. Nowadays we know it's not. Back then, the troposphere chemistry was not really being understood very well. So the interplay between reactive organic carbon and nitrogen oxides. And so this is really summarizing what we try to study. So we try to study the emissions of these trace gases, emissions of non-methane volatile organics, methane and CO, along with NOx. There's different sources. There's anthropogenic emissions, biomass burning, and biogenic emissions. So they're released into the atmosphere. So surface atmosphere exchange, in that sense, is very important to understand because this is where most of the exchange happens and controls the sensitivity of the whole atmospheric system. Then there's complex atmospheric chemistry going on that I'll just very briefly I'm not going to go into too much detail. All you need is the precursor gases that I just mentioned, and you add in radiation and you start to oxidize things in the atmosphere. And then there's two important byproducts that are important from an air quality point of view. One is that we know nowadays that the oxidation of especially these volatile organic compounds produces organic aerosol in the atmosphere that's providing seeds for clouds. And on the other hand, what I already mentioned, they play an integral role in tropospheric ozone production. And so these are the important things why we need to study these trace gases. This is one snapshot for atmospheric aerosol production globally. So what I will talk, what this slide here shows, if we go back, is that part here where you form organic aerosol. These are tiny particles in the atmosphere. And only until probably 10, 15 years ago, since 10 or 15 years ago, people have recognized that a major part of fine particulate matter, so this is what we often call Feinstaub in the atmosphere, consists of organics. That's the green part of the of these pie charts. And each pie chart is the summary of a measurement campaign all around the world. So you see you have many different measurements around the world. On average, organics play a very important role. And this, in the 80s, we did not know about this in that much detail. In the 80s, we thought that mostly sulfate would play an important role, but now we know it's both of those, organics and sulfate. So organic chemistry in the atmosphere, that, for that reason, becomes very important. Now, the other thing I've already mentioned, ozone is damaging, so too much ozone damages crops. That's an example here showing plants that are in clean air. On the left, it's tobacco plants. If you add ozone, if you expose those plants to high ozone levels, they are damaged, as you can see here. And so it's estimated in the US, due to air pollution and high ozone, is about $1 billion of revenue loss because of crop yields going down at elevated ozone. For humans, it's also not good if you're exposed to acute ozone exposure. This is a picture showing down the lung. The ozone can inflame the lung's lining here on the right, seen here, the inflammation, and on the left, it's a healthy lung. So if you have too higher concentrations, ozone is a very high important oxidant. An increase of 10 ppb of tropospheric ozone roughly elevates the risk of respiratory death by 4%. This is shown by a study of Jared et al. In the Journal of New England Journal of Medicine. So what they plot here is the threshold of daily 1 hour maximum ozone levels in the lower atmosphere versus your residual risk. And you see at, starting at the ozone concentration of about 60 ppb, you start to see an increase in the risk of ozone related to the exposure to ozone. Now, old air quality guidelines were quite a bit higher. Nowadays, when we look at that, the EU guidelines, the new EU guidelines closely follow these epidemiological studies where air quality would be marginal, below that level, moderate and serious are classified that way. So if air quality is serious, you should think about doing extraneous outdoor activity, for example, because then it's probably not healthy anymore. So how is tropospheric ozone produced? I've already mentioned it in a snapshot. This is my only complicated slide, but it summarizes the photochemical engine of the atmosphere, of the lower atmosphere. You need nitrogen oxides, NOx. It's the catalyst of the atmosphere that drives ozone production along with radiation. NO2 splits apart and you make ozone. But then there's one important thing missing, and that's that part here. The whole cycle is really driven by reactive trace gases that contain carbon. So it's, so to speak, the fuel of atmospheric chemistry. And as you go through that fuel, you process that. The atmosphere, on the one hand, cleans out pollution gases, these non-methane volatile organics. Of course, the atmosphere also cleans out CO and methane. I just show them these organics here as an example. And you run through this conveyor belt. The atmosphere runs through this conveyor belt in the end, cleaning the atmosphere. But there is some byproducts to that. So we all know what happens when things get a little bit out of control. That's when we talk about air pollution. It's a picture here. There's also recently more reports in the media about air pollution in Austria. If you run through the numbers here, in Europe, people calculate numbers about 1 billion of revenue that's or damage that's done, if you calculate it up. And we all know how bad it can get. That's one recent picture from China. It's generally now called the place where a new term has been created, is the air apocalypse there, because if in many cities in China here, the air pollution, the levels are so high that you cannot it's not healthy to go outside anymore, and people have to wear masks, breathing masks. And so this is really our motivation here. There's a strong connection, air quality and medical sciences, because number one cause of air pollution is lung cancer, and lung cancer is also known to be one of the leading causes of cancer-related mortality. So for the sake of simplicity now, today I'll just focus on that part here, and a lot of our research circles around those compounds that float in the atmosphere that we call non-methane organic volatile organic compounds. It's a complicated name, but what are those compounds? Many of us have already experienced those compounds. These are molecular formulas shown here. The right here is alpha binion. It's the typical scent of a forest, so we know that the biosphere emits vast amounts of these compounds into the atmosphere. The compound in the middle is an example. It's a plant hormone. It's methyl salicylate, so it communicates, or plants use it to communicate stress. And an example on the right is benzene. It's emitted from cars and combustion. So these are just three typical examples of these volatile organic compounds that we subsumize under one term here. When we talk about these compounds, it's not just one single compound, it's many of those. And so we don't know the exact number, but we can guess the numbers, and that's why it's such a complexity that we have to deal with. But we can estimate that there's probably about 1,000, maybe even 10,000 of these compounds floating in the lower atmosphere, released by three common sources: anthropogenic emissions, biogenic emissions, and biomass burning. And so once the atmosphere starts converting these compounds, oxidizing those, there's theoretical studies out there that you're dealing with potentially 1 billion organic compounds or radicals in the atmosphere that undergo this oxidation process. So it's a very complicated thing, and what atmospheric chemists have been trying to do in the last 20 years, 30 years, is to simplify that problem, that we can include these more simplified description of the chemistry in atmospheric models. Now, I've mentioned biogenic emissions. This is one example, a forest in Colorado that we studied very extensively. It's a pine, it's a ponderosa pine forest. And we're looking at how many primary compounds are emitted in that forest. And that just shows one example here, a mass spectrum from one of our instruments, where we see the intensity of compounds, and every peak here represents pretty much a single compound for most cases. And if you count it up, how many peaks do we see in that, and this is only one instrument, it's many of those. So we see many of these non-methane volatile organic compounds in the atmosphere. In that case, we were able to account up to 500 peaks above background values. And so as you can see here, measurement methods are very important here, and I'll come to that a little bit later. If we add it all up and come up with budgets on the global scale and look at these non-methane volatile organic compounds, we can come up with a global budget. But more interesting is also a slice, a vertical slice across the land surface here, where I plot the distribution of these emissions as a function of latitude here and the emission on the y-axis. And there's maybe only one important message here, and that's probably that one, that when we look at the relative fractions, it's biogenic emissions, emissions from plants, that dominate the global budget here. Anthropogenic emissions and biomass burning, even though those are still also very uncertain, play a minor role. They're more important in the Northern Hemisphere, and they can be, of course, important at a very local scale, but globally and regionally, it's those biogenic emissions that drive photochemistry. So we add up all of that, and then we can come up with a gross total amount of what I call here reactive carbon-containing gases in the atmosphere, and that's a global budget. These budgets are very uncertain, and I'll talk about this in a minute. So measurements are very important still to come up with these numbers or refine those numbers, and they serve as the primary input in air quality and climate models. But we can compare now methane, carbon monoxide, and some of all these reactive non-volatile organic compounds. We see that the red part is the dominating one, so more than half what's floating in the atmosphere, more than half of the reactivity is really from these organic compounds. Exceeds methane by far. The total number is pretty significant, so totally there's about 3,000 teragrams of material released into the atmosphere. And so we can compare this to the global fossil CO2 input. It's about 8,000 teragram carbon per year. Now luckily there's, which I already mentioned, all these gases need to be somehow cleaned by the atmosphere, and contrary to CO2, there's good news. The atmosphere has a unique property to take care of that. And this is probably the most important radical in the atmosphere. It's called the detergent of the atmosphere. It's the OH radical. It's produced from photolysis of ozone. So light splits ozone, and then you get an excited oxygen radical. And in the presence of water, you make two OH radicals. And OH is really the main oxidant in the atmosphere. And that takes care of removal of most of these organic trace gases, methane, CO, and NOx. But it's a very coupled system, of course. What I want to show here is that because it's, if you boil it down, if you have a source that makes OH and a source of these reactive gases, mathematically the atmosphere is never in steady state. So you will never be able to reach steady state, and it's a very nonlinear system. And this is what makes it so complicated still to predict even ozone sensitivities. So how do we investigate all these trace gases? It's just shown here. The community has a whole range of arrays available nowadays. You can go in the plant, study biogenic emissions, where you enclose plants and look at their emissions. On the other side of the picture here, we have Earth observing systems nowadays that are coming online, and all the new products here are also a lot of those geared towards measuring organic trace gases in the atmosphere. So we can use those also as a top-down approach to estimate, for example, global emissions. What I'll mostly focus in the next few slides is the area that we are heavily engaged with, and this is where we try to measure the composition of air at the surface. Surface sites, but also more recently, we've collaborating with colleagues in the US to measure these compounds on aircraft. This is a typical example showing a setup where we measure emissions along with micrometeorology in a orchard in California. It's a walnut orchard, and so we set up here our wind sensors and can connect those to our chemical sensors. And then can measure what the plants are emitting in that instance. And the important thing here is that we always want to go out in the real world. We can do plant studies with laboratory studies with plants, but it's really ultimately for atmospheric science that you really want to come up with realistic numbers. And so we engage in these field missions. So these are just shown wind sensors here, arrays of wind sensors that you can use to study turbulence. But then, of course, we also need rapid in situ trace gas analysis. And there we really build on the backbone on what's been invented at the Institute for Ion Physics and Angewandte Physik, group of Armin Hansel also. And there's a spin-off company in Innsbruck now developing really highly sensitive tools to measure all these trace gases. This just shows one of the pictures in our lab recently. But this allows us really to study plumes, very short plumes, and the distribution of these trace gases in great detail. It's not just mass spectrometry that nowadays plays a more and more important role. There's also a lot of optical techniques now coming out to measure methane, CO2, and water vapor along with ozone very fast. So I say very fast. This is very important because changes in the atmosphere often happen on the time scale of a couple of seconds, and so we want to capture that evolution. Of course, some of these instruments, unfortunately, are not really pocket size, but they are manageable nowadays. This just shows one picture for a study in Brazil in 2004, dragging our equipment to that tower here, and also combining with an aircraft study to come up with some of the first profiles of these emission patterns in that area. Some of these are pretty challenging still. More recently, though, we had the luxury to participate in aircraft studies. This, I'm just showing some examples here. A large air quality study that was a collaboration between the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, and NCAR, NSF, to study, again, air chemistry in the southeast of the US. So the southeast of the US is that region here, ranging pretty much from Texas to North Carolina, and the red traces here show our flight patterns. So these are our tracks from one research aircraft, and there was about 30 research missions flown here. And the reason why people here picked that area was specifically, again, because of these biogenic emissions. This just shows an emission map here. And it's known for a long time that most of the air chemistry in that region is driven by emissions from these plants. And particularly, there's one interesting region here that has been dubbed. It's in the Ozarks. It's close to Missouri. It's all red here, if we believe those emission models. It's called sometimes the isoprene volcano, and it's a very interesting region because this is a region where air quality models continuously fail to predict almost anything. And that was one of the motivations for that study. Is it really the air mass controlled by the biosphere? These are some measurements here of OH reactivity. This is a measure of ozone production efficiency, and what we see here, we just need to look at the pie chart and the numbers here. The green part is pretty much the fraction of reactive gases that's emitted from the biosphere, and we can really see it's dominated by these biogenic volatile organic compounds. And sometimes you can see this as even a blue haze, because what happens is these compounds in the atmosphere can nucleate, and then they form a fine aerosol. And this then is shown, sometimes shows up as a blue haze. This is a blue haze from one of our research flights showing a snapshot from the aircraft, looking at down at the forest here. And so, in that sense, it has been very interesting to look at. How does that work when we put these instruments on an aircraft? I just show an example here on a smaller research aircraft where we are involved in a similar study in California. This is the inside of such a research aircraft. It's a flying laboratory. So we have a lot of space limitation, of course, but engineers always manage to cram things into these flight racks. This is our analyzer here, for example, that we use for analyzing these volatile organic compounds. We also have analyzers for methane based on the cavity ring down spectroscopy, CO2, and again, ozone. And so just one example here, a test example of some of these measurements that's shown here. It's Research Flight 5 over California. We fly over that area. And if I start this, hopefully it runs. Yeah, you can see then we're looking out from the co-pilot site here. This is our air take inlet. And these are the measurements along as we fly through the atmosphere. I picked out three compounds here, methanol, acetaldehyde, and some of the other compounds. And now we see what happens when you fly through that smoke plume, which is burning over a rice field due to management practices. And I just show this as an example where it's really helpful and helped atmospheric sciences to get have some significant advances in the last couple of decades by it being able to really then measure changes in the air composition really fast. Now we fly through and we'll see what happens here. So we fly through the plume and suddenly we get a signal, a reading on all these masses. And you can also see how fast things change on such a platform where then you can relate those spikes here to, for example, mission ratios. And this is just one example where we are really depending on the technological advancement of new measurement techniques. This is another example here, pollution over oil fields in California. And I'm showing this because here we are not able to pick out visually any plume or so. But if we start flying through that boundary layer here, we see the oil gas developments. And what I show here is now methane, CO2, and some of their traces. And we didn't even see the plume because it was invisible to our eye, but we see that we pick up these plumes from methane, for example, in that case, and benzene and toluene. And so we can then go back here and say, well, interestingly enough, there was no CO2 enhancement. But from those measurements, we can calculate emission enhancement, for example, and come up with budgets of these trace gases in the atmosphere. In that case, very helpful to have a moving platform, but of course we can also do that on the ground. And so this is an animation now that shows the lowest part of the atmosphere, which is typically 1 to 2 kilometers high, and it's a cross section. It's in a model world, so it's not real. It's a model simulation. It's a large eddy simulation. A cross section through that model of about 30 kilometers. And what you see here is a simulation of such a model that simulates turbulence. And what I want to show is here to give you an idea how the air is moved around in the lower surface. If you run this, hopefully, you can see then that air is rising up and mixes the boundary layer very well. And so what we try to do with these types of measurement systems is to capture all these plumes, so pretty much to do a statistics across the atmosphere. Oops. And from that, we can do a lot of interesting things scientifically. So the idea is here you have the well-mixed boundary layer air, mixes air around, and we fly, in that case, with our research aircraft. If you fly across fast enough, and typically the aircraft speed is fast enough that we can get a snapshot across a certain area, for example, and we have our fast instruments here, we can capture all these different plumes. In the previous movie, I just showed one distinct plume, but we can continuously monitor a whole spectrum of these plumes, and then it looks like this. This is the visualization of the turbulence field for isoprene for a particular research flight. Again, what this shows is our flight track, with a 100-kilometer flight track above the surface, and we see, we can visualize these plumes that are enriched with organic trace gases, isoprene, lifted upward in the atmosphere, and plumes that are depleted, that are mixing air, clean air down. And this is a statistical problem then that's easily solvable if we integrate over all these different plumes. So if it all add up, we can arrive at a total flux and we can actually measure how much of air is moving through the atmosphere and what's the emission. And the reason I'm showing this was showing this animation that for the first time we also used that to study the emissions of methane from those research aircraft. We all know methane is an important climate gas, so it's in that sense important to look at. Well, it turns out that region also is high intensity region in terms of oil production and gas production. And so the question here was how much methane is released from a particular hydraulic fracturing. When we look at the oil production here in the US, it's been declining since 83 here, and then there's a reversal trend here, and it just coincides with the fracturing boom in the US. So what's hydraulic fracturing? I'm sure my colleagues at the geology department know much more about it than I do, so here's just a very probably a naive nutshell of hydraulic fracturing. Has resulted in this energy boom in the US is that engineers have figured out how to drill down through the soil, and some of these boreholes are 4 kilometers deep, so that the well bore here shown here. Then they're able to shift and turn 90 degrees and bore into that shale formation, and then they can extract gas and oil from that shale formation. And so for us, or for this consortium of people flying over these areas, is an important question to answer, and that reduces down to the question, is there a climate benefit for natural gas compared to coal? So when you burn gas, it's much more efficient than coal, it's much cleaner. In terms of the CO2 budget, there's still a big dispute out there. And so there's a seminal paper out there, Alvarez and Pinayes, that says if the methane leakage from these shale gas production sites compared to the captured methane or natural gas is below 3.2%, then there's immediate climate benefit. So then you would have to recommend that switching coal-fired power plants to gas also has a climate benefit. From an air quality perspective, we know that there's always a benefit to switching over to gas. And so when we look at the CO2 fraction of emissions globally now from coal fuels, we see a decline here through the 19th century, the introduction of liquid fossil fuels that has been leveled out a little bit. But the idea or some of the plans would be if you could reduce the coal influence even further below that. And so again, this is where this hydraulic fracturing has really changed the game in the US, where people have been able now to extract actually significant amounts of oil and gas. But from an air quality perspective, the big question mark is how much methane does leak out from these operations. People have very good numbers on the captured part of gas and oil because that's meticulously recorded. The leakage rate, again, from a climate policy point of view, is a very important measure. And so at the first instance, it would sound like it's straightforward. You just go to each site and look for leaks and sum it all up. But it's often more complicated. This is a picture of a typical drilling operation here. So you have many different ways where you could have leaks. There's different operators. It's a very material-intensive way at the beginning to extract oil. So it's not easy to really locate leaks in that system. And on top of that, you have now in the US hundreds or thousands of these drilling stations. So this is a map here, the cross-section about 250 kilometers. Each dot here is either an active or an inactive fracturing site. And so it's impossible to really do a bottom-up emission estimate of the methane leakage. And this is where the idea came in. Well, maybe you can use these aircraft flights here to come up with a top-down estimate. And so this is a summary picture of all the big shale gas reservoirs in the US. And our study was taking us to the southeast again here, the Barnett and Haynesville, and then also the NOAA crew was flying also above the Marcellus shale gas fields. And the idea was that we could measure these methane emissions from our aircraft by that statistical method I just showed. And this shows our research flights, or two research aircraft actually, on top of that map here, with Texas on the left, Louisiana. All these black dots here now are drilling sites and operational shale gas sites where they extract gas and oil. And the colored lines here show the different research flights on two different research aircrafts, the NCAR C-130 that I was involved with, and then the NOAA P-3, where actually Martin Grouse, who's sitting here, was also involved with. And it's a concerted effort here to try to come up with top-down estimates. And again, I want to recall, so the goal was to nail down that number, the 3.2%, because there's been many assessment reports now, even for IPCC, I think, or in Vision for the next IPCC report. And every of these assessment reports uses different numbers. They say it's a very uncertain number. Some even come to the conclusion nowadays that methane has no climate benefit. And so this is a very important question to answer what the leakage rate is. And so if we are below that 3.2%, you could argue, or the energy community could argue, there's definitely a climate benefit on the very short term. We all know there's always a climate benefit maybe in the long term. And so from these measurements now, as a paper submitted by a colleague at NOAA, we get these numbers for Haynesville and Marcellus shale gas reservoirs, which are below that number. So that's in one sense good news. But also even more important, maybe the conclusion here from also other papers is that it seems that a few emitters here cause most of the leakage. So there's probably a very good handle to even further improve that leakage rate. So that's that. And I'll conclude now here. I showed a lot of the previous research, but of course we're also interested in what's going on now here in the Alps. And so our goal here is also across different faculties, hopefully in the future, to revisit a little bit of atmospheric chemistry in these Alpine regions. And I know there's been a lot done already. I see Armin here, who has done a lot of measurements also in collaboration, I think, with the institute I'm part of nowadays. And so what we are really interested in is also a test case here to look at all these trace gases in alpine regions. This is a snapshot from the top of the top of our building here. You can see some of the meteorological sensors here. And we are interested, we had a test case now for maybe half a year to look at these emissions of urban emissions, similar questions, but a different location here. And I would mention here, we also have the privilege to test one of the new nice toys that was developed by Onicon, a mass spectrometer here that helps us to really nail down a lot of these non-methane volatile organic compounds at an unprecedented sensitivity and scale. These are just some very preliminary measurements of benzene fluxes from the city here, but we hope in the future we can do this for a number of different trace gases, and particularly also NOx. And so why are the Alps so interesting? Most of my colleagues know this figure probably better than I do. This shows the temperature anomaly now for the Alpine region in red, the greater Alpine region based on the HistAlp domain. And the black line shows the NOAA-derived global land surface change of temperature. And what we see here, as we know now, it is pretty well established. So it's getting warmer here. The Alps might get even warmer than the rest of the Alps, the rest of the land surface here. But overall, we have been experiencing some of the warming as well here in the Alps. And so people are still speculating to that. But if you look and also at, for example, the solar radiation, the sunshine hours, the yellow curve here, it seems that that's also been going up. And so there's an indication that actually one result of climate change in the Alps is that it's getting nicer. We get more sunnier days, get maybe also more heat waves, but in particular, it's getting a little nicer and we get more temperature. Higher temperatures, more sun here in the Alps. So that could sound like a good news, which sometimes it of course is. But from, again, coming back to an air quality point of view, there's some things that actually are interesting to look at because they amplify to impact air qualities. What does that mean if you have more sun and higher temperature? Well, these are typically also conditions that are more conducive to the accumulation of air pollution. Higher temperatures also mean that more of these natural emissions from plants that are very temperature dependent, go up. And we know that probably also here in the Alps, the biosphere is probably being a significant amount on these precursors. And then when we look at the statistics, it looks also that NOx emissions at least are not going down. If at all, they might be going up. Because of various things here listed. And so all these factors, these amplify or work together to amplify the problem of air pollution in Alps. I haven't really mentioned that also the complex topography plays a role here. But anyway, so this is also where we see our research focused on. We do a lot of fundamental research, but we hope that there's also a close connection to policy making. So science and support decisions. I plot here climate versus air quality. If we consider then a space where air quality can get better or worse, and we let climate or the impact of climate do its own, so it can get better or worse. Most people would argue increasing temperatures would mean that accumulative then. Conditions are less than ideal, so going to that direction. But again, for air quality, we really don't know if the future will get better again. And I should mention, many pollutant gases have been reduced quite a bit, so it's not that there's nothing being done. But in terms of which direction we go in the future, it's not really clear because there's definitely a climate penalty on air quality in the Alps, and maybe more in the Alps than somewhere else, because we know the Alps are warming faster than many other regions. And so if we just extract here air quality gases, what's the implication of that? When we look at the progress, there's definitely progress made in fine particulate matter. So the primary aerosols emitted by cars have been improving quite a bit. CO has also been improved quite a bit. These non-methane volatile organic compound emissions from anthropogenic sources have also been improved, but I show it here yellow because the biosphere is probably dominating that. So, and if then it's getting warmer, probably these emissions might go up. And what we see here, in, not just in the Alps, in Europe, that NOx and ozone keep going up quite a bit. And on the other hand, when we look at budgets of climate gases, I think there's also good news. So in Austria, I think the climate budget has been going, improving a little bit. So the emissions of carbon gases, if you believe the Umweltbundesamt, but it's really the interplay of both, but we are really interested on these air quality gases and how they will develop in the future. And so in that sense, I leave it to the last picture here, where I would like to thank all my colleagues in the past, but also my colleagues at the Institute, colleagues across the university here that I've collaborated in the past. Last but not least, though, I would like to thank you for your endurance and your patience to stay here with me for this hour. Thank you.